She's like, I will take that out of my bag.
Good evening, I'm Tracy Cardis. I'm the Executive Director of Special Education, and I'm thrilled to be here. I started in March. So I've got like something like 37 or 8 years of experience in special education. I worked for years as the parent coordinator in several different districts that I was at. So it's really exciting to see all of you here today.
I'm Blake Lowell. I am a special education coordinator. This is my 7th or 8th year as a coordinator, I think. I can't remember. You think I know. I don't really know. But I've been in Frisco. This is my 15th year in Frisco. So I've been here a while. Lots of growth. And I enjoy what I do. And I don't know, am I supposed to say something that's specific?
I think you're good.
Okay, there we go.
Hi, I'm DJ Lascarza. I'm a SPED coordinator. I've been in education, I think this is my 19th year, if I can add that up really quick, and my 6th year in Frisco.
Oh my gosh, she did that fast. I'm Casey Moss. I'm a coordinator in the special education department. Have a little bit of an interesting background coming from the principalship, so that was a little different than our team. I have no idea what year this is. It's 24 or 25, something like that in education, but I love what I do and I love these people.
Hi, I'm Becky Gaharin. I'm also a special education coordinator. I was doing the math real quick. This is my 28th year in education, 14th year here in Frisco, 4th year in this position.
I'm Cora Wilkins, and I'm one of the special education directors. I'm currently the director of the behavior services. This is my 20-something year in education, period, because I started out as a general ed teacher. Prior to that, I actually had my own child care business, so I have a lot of experience with little babies as well. And I'm really excited to be here. I have been here since July.
I'm Dr. Erin Stanton. This is my 12th year in education, and actually my first year in Frisco ISD, and I'm excited to be here. My background, I've been an SLC teacher and a behavior specialist, and I've been a coordinator in another district, so I'm excited to be a coordinator here in Frisco this year.
And I'm Nicole Park. I'm also one of the new SPED coordinators in my first year at Frisco. It's my 14th year in education. I spent the last 13 years in Louisville, and most of that experience was related to transition services and working with our 18 plus program, and so I'm excited to be here as well.
Hi, I'm Katie Stallings, and I'm the lead SLP in Frisco ISD, and this is my 20th year here, and I think maybe my 15th year as lead. And we have about 80 SLPs in Frisco, and welcome.
And missing from our team tonight are a couple of our directors of special education, Garrett Jackson. You may have seen him before. He's been here for a while. And Christine Davis. Garrett's out of town, and Christine had childcare issues, and she lives far out, so she couldn't come back over this way. Also missing is Rachel Taylor. She got really sick today, and we said, no, you're not coming to infect the parents. So she went home obligingly, and Dr. Shazma Crooks is not here. She's out of town today. And so that's our leadership team, plus the leads of every department. So that those are the people helping support your children and helping to support all the campuses and everything that we do.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. My name is Officer Rad Vertello with the Frisco Police Department. I've been there for the past 8 years, but I actually grew up in Frisco. Graduated Frisco High School, joined the Army, and I'm still here, so I'm proof that the system works. I joined the Army right here in Frisco, met my wife here, my parents still live here, and I just can't afford it anymore, so I moved to Salina, but I still work. But I love Frisco, and growing up here and watching it change from when I moved here in 2002, there was 50,000 people, now there's over 190,000 people. Just watching the system go from the 3 high schools when I went to school to we're building our 11th coming up, lots going on. But also, while I was in school, I was involved with the special education program, hanging out with those kids that were my age and watching them. I'm still friends with them, going to the Special Olympics, and I've always had a great relationship, and I love being around them. They make your world light up every time you get to see them succeed. You succeed with them, and that's something that's really cool. Retired Plano Sergeant A.D. Paul introduced me to a program called Positive Police Interaction that they had in Plano. And everything that Plano has, we want it but better. So I went and met with him and sat in one of these classes, and it was truly amazing. It was an hour-long class. The first 30 minutes was spent meeting, having some officers meet with the kids, talking with them, showing them what an interaction might look like, just walking into an officer on the street, or we might get called to a call where that it might involve somebody with special needs, like sitting on a bench even. So we play out that scenario just so that they're familiar with what officers are doing and how to interact and what officers are thinking and everything. The last 30 minutes is traffic stops. The class was geared towards high school age kids where they would sit in a car and the police officer would sit in their car, they would turn on the lights and sirens, they would initiate a traffic stop, cars didn't move, turn off the siren and walk out up to the car and make initial contact. Just like, you don't have to raise your hand, but there's a couple people in here probably been pulled over before. I'll name them out. I've been pulled over before, and even somebody that is not special needs or anything like that, it's a nerve-wracking experience even to get pulled over as an officer. When I'm headed home and I get pulled over by Prosper because I'm running late for dinner, I still get my heart racing, and I'm a cop. So that says something. So what are these kids going through? So that's something that Sergeant A.D. Paul took into account and walked through step by step. This is what a traffic stop looks like. This is what the interaction looks like, and this is what you can do. So I thought, that's awesome. So when he retired, I said, I got you, and I took the program, and we're starting it here soon. And we're working with FISD. And then kids and parents will be encouraged to come out here in certain size groups. And I'm gonna start by coming to the schools and kind of an after school deal, and we'll go through the class. Happy to answer any questions. I've got cards out there. It says Officer Abatello on there. Be sure to grab you one if you have any side questions you'd like to ask, or give me an excuse to get away from my desk, come up to the police department. I'd be happy to talk to you.
Do you want to play the video now?
The video?
I got it.
You got that, Ted?
Yeah.
That's what's up. So this is essentially where I believe A.D. Paul got it from, and he took it, made it better, and now we're going to take it and make it even better than this.
Young people with autism is the goal of the new program.
CBS 2's Suzanne Lemonnier shows us how it works. Sirens, flashing lights,
who likes this in insurance?
Verbal commands.
I don't know where it went to.
No insurance card, sir? All right now I'm checking out your license.
A traffic stop can make your heart race.
You match the description. Somebody was breaking the vehicles.
Or a person with autism, a moment like this can create sensory overload.
And to freeze up, can have a lot of trouble following these commands from the officer.
Brandon Lesh is an occupational therapist at Marion Joy Rehabilitation Hospital.
If lights out, that's something that you can get pulled over for.
The hospital has partnered with the DuPage County Sheriff's Department and offers courses to teach young people with autism how to interact with police during traffic stops.
What were you doing here?
I came here to wish my friend Brandon a happy birthday.
Will Ogilvy is taking part in the course.
I felt it was important because I needed to be more comfortable if such a situation ever arose, though.
The deputies have been learning from this as much as the students learning from the deputies. Yeah, that's for sure.
So it's really something that goes hand in hand, which is interesting.
It absolutely is.
Stuart Ogilvy is Will's father.
That was important for me to come with him. That way I learned what he's learning, and we can reinforce it with each other.
What did you learn?
I learned that anything can happen. And you should always be positive and honest with a police officer. And don't be afraid. Don't be nervous.
Suzanne Lemonnier, CBS 2 News.
Organizers of the program also suggest parents put their child's special needs status in the Illinois Secretary of State's emergency contact database. That will help make law enforcement aware of the person's situation immediately. For more information.
All right.
Good deal.
That segue.
Ours is going to be better. The end. But that's pretty much what it looks like. It's an hour-long course that'll be going through, and after we get it going through FISD, we're going to open it up to the entire city, homeschool kids and everybody. Thank you. Maybe. Oh, here we go. We'll be opening it up outside. This isn't just for Frisco exclusively, so if you have folks that are living in Prosper, Salina, Little Elm, McKinney, wherever, we're going to eventually open it up to all surrounding, because we want as many folks as we can get in that program. But as she was mentioning, there was a database. Frisco also has a database called Take Me Home. Is anybody familiar with this? Awesome. Take Me Home is a wonderful program. Go to friscopd.com/takemehome, and that's going to be the website to get to. What you'll do is you'll take your loved one's information, and you'll put it in there. There's going to be a recent picture, basic name, identifying information, what they look like, where they live. But they're also going to say, what do they like? Where do they like to go? What do they like to eat? Is there anything they're afraid of? Is there any phrases that might trigger them? Anything of that nature that might let us know what's going on. Perfect success story for you. There was a kiddo that ran away from home. Mom's panicking. He was on the spectrum, pretty severe, but couldn't even give us information other than the name. She's not sure what to do. But she entered him in the Take Me Home program already. And so we learned through the program what he looked like, had a recent picture, and that he loves water, loves to go to the pond. So that's the first place we started looking, was all the ponds in the neighborhood. We ended up finding him, but the system also said that he was very scared of law enforcement, anybody in a uniform. So we didn't just go running after him trying to get him to come back home. We tried to call him over, we tried to talk to him, wasn't happening. System also said he loved Snickers bars. So one of our officers ran down to QT, grabbed a Snickers bar, said, hey man, and he came sprinting over to him. Got the Snickers, got him home safe. This is also good for parents, those, you know, suffering from dementia, Alzheimer's, on that end. This is everybody that's going to have a hard time communicating. This is what that program's for. So if you have a loved one like that, that fits the profile, please put them in here. This is not for just your everyday teenager that's trying to sneak out of the house. It's not what this is about. This is for those that actually need the program. That's Take Me Home. Again, friscopd.com/takemehome. And there was one more thing.
You're telling what you're about to do.
That's what it is. I have to leave, and this is why. Thank you very much. For parents, and pretty much anybody 18 and up, twice a year we hold what's called Citizens Police Academy. You come to the police department for 9 weeks in a row every Thursday night, usually runs from about 7 till 9, and you get to learn every single little piece of the police department that you ever wanted to know. And then you get to see all of our equipment and hang out with us, and at the end we put you in a police car, we run you through our qualification track, and you just learn, and it's a great way to interact and ask questions. If there's ever been any questions of, hey, why do police do this? Why do they act this way? What is it about this in particular? Come learn. Let's openly talk about it. Let's have a discussion. The Frisco Police Department has always been keen on community interaction. My whole job is a community services officer. So if there's ever any questions, anything you want to know, any program that we might offer, I'm here for you. And my cards are outside, and you can always give me a call. And up on the slide, there's going to be my contact information as well, and a phone number and an email. So I'm looking forward to seeing you and your kiddos come to the class. I'm really excited about it. So guys, yes, ma'am.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
What's the age range for this? Is it what is it?
What's the age range? Thank you very much for the question. Awesome. She's actually been through the course because she's awesome like that. High school age kids, those that are about to drive or of that driving age, maybe they are driving, maybe they won't be driving. It's a great way to get to know interaction with police in general, but it is geared towards the older kids, the high school age kids and a little bit older. Great question. Thank you. Any other questions? Thank you so much.
Okay, next up, I'm going to pull the PowerPoint back up and click. Okay, Susan, come on up. Susan Sen is our assistant tech gal.
That's really the only introduction I need.
No, you need to say more.
Hi, I'm Susan Sen. This is my 27th year as a speech-language pathologist and my 21st year here in Frisco ISD. I've been here so long that I believe Officer Rotello was in high school at Frisco when I worked there. So that's a little humbling. Like I said, I'm on the assistive technology team. There are two of us that deal with a variety of assistive technology needs for the district. We work with students with hearing impairments, We work with students who have writing disabilities, physical disabilities, who need some access. But we work with an awful lot of students who have communication disorders. And we provide assistive technology devices, AAC devices. We do lots of training and things like that. I'll be in the back if anybody has any questions about assistive technology or about communication devices. But I'm very happy to be here. Thank you.
Okay, next up we have Natalie and Regina here to represent the motor team. You guys got tagged.
It's a big team. Thank you for having me.
Sure. Hi, I'm Natalie McPhail, and I'm one of the adaptive PD teachers for the district. And I go in and help students who have severe physical disabilities access the PE curriculum if they can. We also have a wonderful program called Partners PE in the middle schools and the high schools, which is a wonderful opportunity for students with special needs to work with their same age peers, and we do a variety of activities. And that leads us into the Special Olympics. A lot of the times we get to practice our Special Olympics in Partners PE. Special Olympics through the school is done during the school day. We participate in bowling. We participate in basketball skills, and we also have a big track meet in the spring that is district-wide, and we try to bring in a lot of the community, and it's a big event to showcase what all of our students with special needs can do.
Hi, I'm Regina Pig, a physical therapist. We have six PTs in the district, and I'm one of them. This is my second year in Frisco ISD. I'm actually a native of Frisco. I grew up here, graduated from Frisco High.
Did you know Officer Rad?
Yes. I've been to both retired school teachers from Frisco. I grew up here when there was only one elementary school, one middle school, and one high school. So it's been really fun to see how it's grown. And I've been a therapist for 20 years. I worked in Plano ISD for 8 years and got to Frisco as soon as I could. So I'm excited to be here. So I'm a PT. I work with all of our kiddos in the district that have severe gross motor disabilities or challenges. The motor team helps out a lot with all of the Special Olympics things that Natalie and her team heads up. We're excited to be here. Is there anything else interesting?
I guess we'll be in the back.
Yep, we'll be in the back. You guys have any questions? Thanks for having us.
Natalie, tell your numbers and then Frisco Flyers.
My numbers?
Your numbers. How long have you been to
Frisco? Oh, okay. Yeah,
everybody's saying that.
Okay.
I've been in Frisco for 7 years and this is my 22nd year teaching adaptive PE. And the Frisco Flyers is a community Special Olympics, so that's nice carry through if you want your students to do an outside activity. This community has so many things. Frisco Flyers is our Special Olympics team, and they do a lot more sports, including swimming in the summer. They do track and field, bowling, golf, horseback riding, you name it, they can do it. And those are all after school hours, so that's another opportunity for you as well. Thank you.
Okay, we do have the website for the for the Frisco Flyers here. That is right here. And then another great opportunity that we have here in Frisco is Miracle League. And if you need information about that, let us know. We can get you information. We have it in our lending library. But we're going to talk more about that later.
It's on the back of the handout.
On the back of the handout is the information about Miracle League. Okay, so back to our PowerPoint. Next up. We have us. Come on, girls. No, you're coming in. She's manning. You're womaning something? No, you're not. Okay, so we are your district's in-home parent trainers. I'm Colleen Kugler. I have been in education, special education for 25 years. This is my 16th year in Frisco, and I think 12th year as an in-home parent trainer, and it's the best job ever. I love it. Hi, I'm Kristen Foster. I also have been in Frisco actually since 2000, but took off some time to be with my kiddos, and then I came back to be here because of her for the last 10 years, I guess.
That's it.
Hi, I'm Kimberly Gipshi, and I've been in Frisco ISD as a parent trainer for 8 years.
Okay, so we kind of split the district. So we have some of your schools, each split it three ways. So if you have questions about which one of us is over your school, you can come to our table at the end and ask us, and we can tell you. So we also put on the group parent trainings once a month. And you have a handout with all of the trainings for the school year. You're also getting a s'more once a month. That comes directly from the district. If you're not getting that, let us know and we'll make sure that you're getting it. We send that to the teachers as well, and it is full of all of our events for that month and then community events as well and other resources that pertain to families of children with special needs. So I know it's a lot of information, but if you get the time, scroll through. If you have questions about any of the events, you can always reach out to us. Our contact information is on that s'more as well. Another resource that we have is our webpage. And I'm gonna pull that up for you. So on our webpage, you can find all of our, here's the s'more, by the way. I have that right here. This is what it looks like. So it comes from the district. Sometimes it may go to junk, so if you're not getting it, check your junk. It's not junk. Kimberly puts this together and she puts hours and hours and hours into it, so please don't just hit delete. Okay, so here is our webpage, and on here we have our calendar events. As you can see, there we are, September 19th, meet and greet, and then the next up we have Potty Talk here at the ECS in the afternoon of October 18th. And our next group parent training that we have in the evening is What I Wish I Knew. And parents are going to be here like in a panel talking about, they have older children and they're gonna talk about all of the things that they wish they knew when their children were young. And we're gonna have community providers here as well. They're at that training, we try to have them at each training, whoever pertains to the training. So we're reaching out to LifePath. We're reaching out to other, you know, Denton County MHMR, talking about the list to get on, talking about everything you need to know to be prepared for your child to be an adult, because it happens really, really fast. So you're gonna get some great information from this series. One big thing that we have on this site is all of our group parent trainings that we've had in the past two and a half years now are on here for you to watch. So we're videotaping right now. This meet and greet will be on the website in about a week. I give it to Bob Burnett at Frisco High School, and he works some magic and turns it into a video, and we post it on the website. So if you missed some information, want to go back, you can watch it. Or if you have a friend that didn't get to come, direct them to the website. Okay. The Parent Sanctuary and Lending Library. This is one of our biggest resources that we have here that we provide in the district. There's a video tour you can watch on the website. At the very last part, if you're walking around asking your questions, take some time to check out the Parent Sanctuary and Lending Library. It's right out these doors. We have almost 2,000 items in there for parents to check out for 2 weeks for free. We have sensory materials. We have weighted blankets. We have fidgets. We have tons of books related to any parenting topic you can think of. We have binders full of visuals ready to take home that are already laminated. And if there's anything you need laminated, printed, we have a color printer in there, a computer coming on Fridays, and we're there as in-home parent trainers, and we can help you produce something for your home, tailored specifically to your child. So we're in there on Fridays, and on Mondays and Wednesdays, we have parent volunteers in there, and we call them our angels because that is exactly what they are. They have the biggest hearts, angels back there. Yep, Shauna is here, she's there every Wednesday, and Jenny keeps popping her head in, she's there on Mondays, and we now have a mom from India who's in there on Mondays, and we have a parent who speaks Spanish, and she's going to start coming in, so that she's going to be there on Fridays to be there with us, so that she can translate for any families that speak Spanish. We also have two shelves full of items in Spanish, parenting materials and children's materials as well in there. So if you have any items you'd like to donate, everything in there, the district did not spend a dime in there, just so you know. That is all donations between Frisco Education Foundation, Frisco Sage,
PTA, those are all donations. Teachers have donated books. I have a bunch of books in there. We all have donated books, and all the parents that come in there, a lot of them donate things as well. So you have things you're not using anymore, please drop them off right at the front desk of the ECS or bring them when you come to the next parent training. We would love, love, love to have any donations. So all the information about the hours and location, all of it is there also on our website. Next up, you can find the information. We're going to talk a little bit about SIP Shop, Team Squad, but there are slides for that, so I won't go into that now. Tons of resources on here. If you are in the process of potty training, the potty talk is taped and on here, the video is on there, and then all of the materials you need and visuals you need are all here, so you can print and use at home. If you want extra clarification on there, come in on a Friday and we will help you out with that. There's tons of visual schedules, rules, and routines on here that you just click, print, and you have it. You can, a lot of them you can also adapt to as Word documents. A ton of sensory strategies makes our motor team happy. and then we have a bunch of social scripts and then a section for futures planning. So take some time to go through those. We put a lot of work and make sure we have as many resources for you as possible on that website. We have a Facebook page. If you haven't liked it already, it's FISD Special Needs and Events. Everything is, you know, we are putting things on there all the time. Pictures of things going on, community events. I had a mom recently say, oh, I just need to know what's going on the weekend. I'm like, Facebook page. When we get things, we put them right on there so you guys know what's going on coming up real soon. Then we already went through the Parent Sanctuary and Lending Library and the Monthly S'more. So that was a lot of information in my breath. Okay, now I'm going to switch roles and half put on my SIP Shop shirt.
That's hard to say.
Okay, and I need my SIP Shop helpers to come up, please. Where are you? You're hiding. Oh, there they are. Okay, so Aya Azadine is gonna tell you about her experience as a SIP Shopper. And her mom, Tiffany, is going to tell you her experience as a mom whose three children have gone through SIP Shop. And then we're going to show you a little video, and Aya's in it when she's really, really cute. Okay, Aya, tell them what you think of SIP Shop.
Okay, so SIP Shop is just a group where kids with siblings that have special needs can just come in, relax, play games, and talk to their peers that also have, like, the same situation as them. They get to learn about ways to deal with problems at home and like just different ways to deal with things. And it's just a good way to get to know people and have a good time with friends.
Hi, I'm Tiffany Azadine. I had a daughter that started here in early childhood when she was three. At that time, I only had four kids. We currently have five. She was on the low end of the spectrum when she started here, and we were struggling with lots of things at home. And sometimes you don't realize that the other three were getting left behind, you know, like I wasn't quite kind of going over their problems and their needs because I was so wrapped up in my special needs child's needs. So SIP Shop was an awesome way for them to let some of those things go. Realize that other kids out there are going through the exact same thing that they're going through and that it's not something to be embarrassed about. So they would come out of SIP Shop in the evening and they'd talk about it. They would tell us like, oh yeah, somebody else did this, or their brother was screaming through Walmart, or you know, they dumped a shelf at the Dollar Tree, or you know. So it kind of opens that conversation, but it also gives them a safe place to talk with their friends. And then they've gotten to know lots of kids in the district. So SIP Shop, it kind of goes across all the schools. So they see each other out in the community and they're like, hey, how are you? You know, and it's just a really great connection for them on a different level. So we would love for you guys to get involved, come out, bring your kids, let them get to know all the other kids, and hopefully it'll be a great and amazing experience for you guys as well.
And Aya is now one of our team leaders. So as the kids have gone through it through the years, they get to become a team leader, and she earns service hours, which you haven't turned in. They earn service hours for helping out, and it's just
Oh, she's amazing. Like, she literally could run the show herself, and she has before. So, yeah. And if you need more information about SIP Shop, I'll be over at the table after, and you can get the list of events for the school year. The list of events for the school year, and also I have over there, two years ago, the kids all worked on a whole list of what they wish parents knew about SIPs, of kids with special needs. So that list is over there if you'd like to come get one. Okay, so here's a video we did a few years back, and I just wanted you to see it. The kids are actually talking this year about doing a new video, so we'll see if we can get that together. But you'll see eye on there.
Sometimes I feel embarrassed, guilty, ashamed, isolated, resentful, responsible, and pressured. I have been graced with amazing perspective and insight, social awareness, appreciation, tolerance, pride, loyalty, and an abundant heart.
Thank you. like a
page. We haven't posted in a long time, but they did such a good job on that. That was so fun. So we will try to get a new one up. Okay, next we have Kristen Foster is going to talk about Teen Squad, and she has a special guest. Come on up, and we're going to use Austin.
Lowe's knows you're the handy man who does it right.
It's brought to you by Commercial
Break.
That just broke up any stress that we had.
Everybody take a deep breath. Stress they have. What about me?
I know you love this. Hi, I'm Kristen Foster, and I guess it's been about 8 years now that Teen Squad was started. It is a social skills group for Frisco ISD students, and we started with kiddos that are on the autism spectrum. But we've since expanded a little bit, and just kiddos that have high school and above, sorry, that have difficulty navigating their social world. And we do monthly meetings and monthly socials, and we try to bring in as many speakers as we can. Officer Rad was one of our speakers last spring, and Amanda was there, and Amanda was able to experience what it would be like to be pulled over by a police officer. We also do some holiday parties and end of year parties, and we've done proms and we've gone places out, and we've toured the Star. That was so fun. So I was going to ask, I asked Amanda to come up and share with you a few things about Teen Squad that she enjoys and has learned.
Hi, you already know me as Amanda. Sorry about that. Right here, not being in front of people, it's been a while. So Teen Squad to me is a program where like special needs kids can like just come and like, well, be themselves and just kind of, you know, hang out, I guess, and learn about like things that maybe they didn't know before about kind of life, I guess. Well, we talk a lot about like the police thing, where we like learn how to be pulled over and not like freak out. We also learn a lot about like how to like shake hands, you know, just kind of be like socially normal, I guess. I mean, not like in a bad way, not that it's a bad, well.
So, for example, we learned about how it's okay, about how to make friends, how to keep friends,
yeah,
how to give compliments. What else did we learn?
We learned how to like just give, like just be well, we did yoga a lot.
We have learned that they benefit from yoga, and why does yoga help?
Well, yoga helps to like relax your body and just kind of relieve your stress from that day, and it just kind of, well, just helps.
Right.
I mean,
so why don't you share, what was your favorite Teen Squad?
Okay, my favorite Teen Squad meeting has to be the Star. Also, like, well, there's a couple, but, you know, I don't want to name, well, because there's other people who have to talk, but, okay. Here we go. Things I like are the fun outings that we take, the helpful lessons that we are given every day, like every time we go anyway, and the friends that are new and old and that I get to talk to and just meet them if I don't know them. Just like, new friends are always like that person that you get to like say hi and like, you know, just be able to tell them kind of things you that maybe make your, you know, like, I guess in my opinion, new people just kind of give you a new opening to give yourself more just kind of makes people, makes yourself feel more kind of special, I guess. I mean, because like you get to tell them more. They don't really know you, right? So they don't really know what's happened in the past. They see past that. Like they just kind of.
So is Teen Squad a comfortable place for you?
Yeah.
Is it a place where you can share with other people that are there, that what you've been through?
Yeah.
Great. Awesome. Well, thank you.
Okay, next up we have Jaylene. She is the PTA stage chair for the district.
I heard a moan, no. Hi,
Jaylene. I got all emotional because I'm watching the sip shop. So, hi, I'm Jean Lee, and I am the SAGE chair for Frisco ISD. I just want to introduce a couple of our other members. We have, no or not? Okay, let's see. Okay, I'm reading. I don't like to speak.
You're doing great,
okay,
Jean.
Okay, thank you. So our PTA across Frisco ISD features a SAGE chair on pretty much all the campuses. So it's available in elementary, middle school, and high school. So if you're a member of the PTA and you would like to advocate for your child, this is a great way to advocate for your child, so please volunteer. Let's see, and it's also part of the executive board, and so you're advocating not just for your child to be included, but also for all of the SAGE students within the school and within the district. So I myself have a high-functioning autistic daughter that's in middle school right now in eighth grade. And we moved here when she was in third grade, and that's when I first joined the PTA, and I was asked to be the SAGE chair in fourth grade. And I never knew something like that existed, and I was amazed that a school district had it, or even the elementary schools had it. And it's a great way to just promote inclusion and to just share your child's story and to get your child the resources or just advocating for programs and just everything you want your child to have. But our PTAs across Frisco features an entire membership that advocates and supports all inclusion of all students on the state, not just on the district level, but on the state level. Through Texas PTA and our state capital, as well as our national PTA and the nation's capital. Texas lawmakers will be considering overhauling special education funding in the 2021 session. So Texas just committed more money to it, which resulted in more special ed teachers hired this past summer and now on campuses. But we still need more. We support and encourage programs to help students understand diverse abilities through Diverse Abilities Day at our elementary school and middle school campuses. So if you have an elementary school student, ask them, do you guys have Diverse Abilities Day at your school? Ask them what it's about. If they tell you that they have it, that they're gonna do it, ask them questions when they do it. What did you learn? You know, ask your friends and their kids, oh, how was Diverse Abilities Day? What did you guys share about? What was most important? What do you remember? Because the more questions you ask them, the more feedback you get, and the more they will share, and the more information will get out to the other families, the other students. Sorry, really not talking, not like talking. So Diverse Abilities Day, for those that don't know, Diverse Abilities Day is when students experience different abilities, diverse abilities, not disabilities. They get to experience different abilities firsthand through interactive stations and learning. So we partner with campus groups like Wakeland High School's Legacy Friends to make and provide homecoming moms. You know how I moved to Texas and I was like, I've been to homecoming, but not like Texas homecoming. I was like, what's a mom? And when I saw the pictures and the amount of money you guys spent on that, I'm like, sorry, but they do this for their FA class, you know, for students, special needs students, you know. if you don't have that on your campus, ask. You know, there's no harm in asking. All they can do is say, oh no, we don't. Would you like to help start it? We ask and encourage you to join us in supporting and advocating for inclusion of all students by joining the PTA. So if you're not a member of the PTA, your PTA membership helps to fund programs like Diverse Abilities Days, like getting scholarships, not just for your gen ed students when they graduate high school, but also special needs students get a scholarship too. Did you know that? It gives us a louder voice in the Frisco ISD and at the Texas Capitol with legislators and senators and the nation's capital with members of all branches. So just, let's see, when they passed the age, changed the age for vaping, right, from 18 to 21, that was because of Texas PTA, and I didn't know about that. And I was like, wow, you know, we all have a voice. So not just special needs kids, all parents, you know. I was, yeah. let me see, what else? We have a Facebook page for Frisco PTA. SAGE itself does not have a separate Facebook page, but if you have any questions, you can contact me through the Frisco PTA SAGE chair, and it's just sage@friscopta.org. Very simple. So I'm more than happy to answer questions. I'm kind of like a resource or support for all the other SAGE chairs on the campus. So, but if you can't reach your campus chair, feel free to reach out to me. I never, you know, not reply. I'm always trying to be helpful, trying to help families find the resources they need. I didn't know about in-home parent trainers. I didn't even know that my daughter could be diagnosed. We were denied, not denied. They said, no, she does not have autism. She does not have autism. I started getting her evaluated when she was 4 years old. And we lived in California at the time. They said, no, she's not on the spectrum. Are you sure? No, she doesn't check off all the boxes. We moved to Texas. They changed the DSM. And all of a sudden, yes, she does fall. She does have autism. You know, finally, someone to acknowledge, yes, my daughter has autism. She can get the support and services that she needs. And that's what we're here for.
So many studies show that when parents are involved in schools, their kids do better. And Jeanlee is a perfect example of that. She jumped in right away when she came here, and that enabled her to meet so many amazing people, other parents, and she's networked. She finds, if she has a question, she finds an answer right away. And she's been through it, so if you want to get involved, please see her or see any of these other amazing people in the room to find out how you can get involved. If there's one thing you learned tonight, please get yourselves involved so that you can have those opportunities as well. And your child will then have the opportunities. Okay, next up we have Kylie Coons and Jennifer Russell, and they're here to tell you all about the things that Frisco Parks and Rec is doing for our kids with special needs. We're very excited. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Kylie Coons. I'm Jennifer Russell, and we are the special event planners for the City of Frisco.
So not only is it the Parks and Rec Department, but we're Play Frisco, and we think it's very important for all people to get out and play. So we do all the special events. So we do like Mary Main Street, Frosty 5K, Mother Son Dance, Burning Boards, all these different events for the city. Mother Sunday is one of our events that's coming up, but we have something very special for all of our sensory sensitive and special needs kids.
So first of all, let me tell you a little bit about us. We've been in this position for 2 years, and so for 2 years we've been planning the special events, and we inherited most of these events. Mary Main Street's almost 30 years old. Daddy Gardens has been around, and the largest Daddy Gardens in the world, and it's been around over 25 years. So we inherited a lot of things, but what we've tried to do is create some different experiences, change some of them, let it grow with the community as the community's growing. And we actually have a talent, and that is, and it's
not skateboarding, and we're not parents of special needs students, and we're not therapeutic recreation specialists. But our talent is recognizing opportunities, things that people need or want. So just an example, Burning Boards is a very successful skateboard competition that we host at our skate park, Frisco Skate Park, which is the second largest skate park in Texas. It's a free competition, free to come to, but we do not know how to skateboard. We do not know what an ollie is. We do not know what kind of music they listen to, but it is an amazing event. And so what our talent is identifying partners that we're gonna work with. So we find someone that's an expert, and we're really good at putting on events, and so we partner with them, and they tell us all the things that we need to do, and we tell them how to put on an event, and we come up with these pretty great things. Another example of that is Frisco Festival of Colors. I don't know if any of you went this year, but we partnered with the Temple here in Frisco and put on a color festival, and it was amazing. It was so amazing. And so that's our talent. So what's happening this weekend is Mother's Sunday, which we've had for over 10 years.
10 years?
I don't know, a long time.
This is the 18th annual Mother's Sunday.
Okay, it used to be at Wakeland. And I worked that at Wakeland. It was in the cafeteria there, and it was fun. But we have moved it to the Embassy Ballroom, so it is a huge, I mean, y'all look at that. It is amazing. So our story, though, is our first year having this dance, we had 2,000 people come. We loved it. It was amazing.
Two different dances. 2,000 people at one time, 2,000 people at another time.
It was amazing.
Chaos. Wow. Yeah. Boys, fight dancing, and all that's a thing.
Fight dancing is huge.
Yeah.
So, but we come out into the foyer where everyone gathers, and there's a mom sitting with her son, and she is bawling. She is so upset, and she asked if we could just, could we bring her some cookies or things from inside, because she wants to go, but her son does not want to go in. And she wanted this to happen. She wanted it to be a special experience for them. And he didn't care. He was sitting out there in the foyer, but he wasn't going in there. And she was so disappointed. So we
thought about it. Every year. Every year. Dance, daddy, daughter, dance, mother, son, dance. It's wild. It's crazy. It's overwhelming for us.
Yes.
We have to step out multiple times.
It's amazing, but it is very overwhelming. So we partnered.
Partnered our talent. Best Buddies
here in Frisco, and if you know them, they are amazing. They do such a great job training volunteers, and they host high school dances. And so basically we said we're already doing this. It's already done. 5:30, 7:30, we've got these dances going on. It's already decorated. We already have the food. We have the DJ. Let's add another time and tell us what to do that this mom can bring her child and have a good time. So that's the creation of the sensory sensitive dance. And it's morphing into something. I think we had 50 participants last year.
We limit the ticket numbers. We have static lights. They're not moving all around. We have a steady tempo of music, still loud, because we've been told that they still love the loud music, but just very same tempo. We have a quiet room. We leave it actually open for all the dances because everybody needs a break every now and then. So there's Play-Doh and color boards and all that kind of stuff just right next to the ballroom that you can go and take a break in. It's actually very successful, that room. We just left the stuff out from last time. There were still kids in there, all thrilled with the dances. So
Best Buddies wrote this for us, but it says, please come enjoy this amazing event for the entire family. This dance is designed to be a sensory-friendly environment. Music will be at an easy-to-listen and consistent level with no flashing lights in muted, lighted, ADA-accessible setting. Sound-reducing headphones are welcome, and quiet areas will be available for attendees. And so what we did is, it's not a Mother's Son dance. It's just tagged on to our Mother's Son dance. It can be daddy-daughter. It can be the whole family. Grandma can come. It doesn't matter. Anyone can come to this dance, and the family can come have fun, and you can try it out. And it's not just for sensory. So we have a grandparent actually contacted me, and she was like, I have sensory sensitivity, and I want to know if I can bring my grandkids to this. Yes, please come and enjoy. It's fun. It's also a good time that just for young children or any child that hasn't experienced a dance, because this is like prom, y'all. This is a big thing. So if they haven't experienced that, but you don't want to invest $22 a ticket and possibly not even make it in the door, it's $10. $10 a person, come in, it's an hour, dress up, have fun, it's casual. If you never make it in, okay. It's only $20 and you know, it'll be okay. And you don't have to be embarrassed, you don't have to worry that anyone cares because everyone there is a party. It's a party, so come have fun. If you want to join us, it's this Saturday. So, plenty of tickets, you don't have to worry about that. You can just buy them online.
Buy them day of, buy them when you get there.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. So, that's what we're talking about today, but we'll also let you know that Frisco Parks and Rec is now Play Frisco. So when you see Play Frisco, that's Frisco Parks and Recreation. We have the Hope Park. A lot of you may know Hope Park. That's our park, and it's inside of Frisco Commons. We maintain that. And
Miracle Field.
Yeah,
the Marfield.
At Bacchus. And then we also have the Miracle League hosts their basketball league is actually in our Frisco Athletic Center. So that's on Sunday nights in the Frisco Athletic Center. But please get to know Play Frisco. We have a lot of free and wonderful things. We also have paid programming. So we bought the Frisco Fun Guide, and we'll talk about that in a moment.
Play Frisco magazine.
And so there's a lot of opportunities in there. So check that out. And if you have any questions, let us know.
So it'll just be for Mother's Son Dance, but it is open for Daddy Daughter Dance. So this portion, the 4 to 5, is open for anybody. So it could be a dad and a daughter, it could be mom, son, it could be mom and daughter. Anybody can come to that dance. That's just the 4 to 5 classes.
And we do have the break room for the Daddy Daughter Dance. It wasn't utilized as much. I'm not sure why, but we loved it so much at the mother-son that we had it available at the daddy-daughter, and they didn't use it as much, but that is available there. The daddy-daughter dance is already 4 dance times of an hour and a half, so we party from 2 o'clock until 10 o'clock, and it is
6,000 people.
We can't fit any more into that day. Yeah. So this one, that's why we have partners. This one because there's only 2 dance times pre-programmed, so we have a little more time. And we want to get with the 18, I see her back there. She works with the 18 plus because we've had a lot of people contact us about their adult children that they want to take to this. So maybe we can find a way to,
Do you still offer the social skills class there too?
Hello, Frisco Athletic Center. Yeah. We did have one class. We're having a lot of trouble getting people interested. Okay. So I know they were working with someone. That's Alyssa Malone, and she's in this book as well. But those classes are in here. But if you have some ideas,
yes.
Well, I remember seeing it in the Frisco Guide. That's why.
Yeah, she did, and it was in our zone area, and they come from the Frisco Athletic Center. But if you guys have ideas or things that you need. That's what we do. We program, and sometimes we can't think of fun things, you know?
Quick question for you. So we moved here over the summer, and I was making a mad scramble, and I didn't know if I missed sign up dates or anything, but does Play Frisco or Parks and Rec offer any summer camps specifically for special needs kids?
I think this last summer they did, but again, we have trouble finding people that are interested, and we kind of have like a mandate that if people only 5 people show up, a lot of times the instructor won't hold that class, and if it doesn't make for a certain amount of time, then they'll remove it from the schedule. So you guys know how to get that word out. That's what we would love for you to do, because a lot of people say, I wish you had a class, a yoga class for kids, and I'm like, we have a yoga class for kids. You know, so sometimes it's just about asking, but also getting people interested and trying to get the word out that we have that service. It's hard.
When should you start looking for things like that?
So our summer camp guide comes out in April. Yes, and she's programming. Our programming is due for spring next week, And then our programming for summer is due in January. So if you have interest, and come see me and I'll give you the email. But, or if you have ideas, or some of you that have programs maybe that already exist that we could partner with you to do, email us now, because that's something that we could make happen for next summer.
Is there a therapeutic rec, like Frisco?
Frisco does not have a therapeutic rec program.
Okay. I don't know about that, so I'm curious.
I don't know if they do. I think they do the schools, they have a therapeutic rec, right?
No. I will say that we've been talking about it for years, but please, spread the word. People have to show up. I can't tell you how many classes I've worked on with Alyssa, and she'll host a class there, and people don't show up, so then they stop. So if you guys want programs, you want things to go, do what you're doing tonight, show up. And then they will see the interest, and they will see that, you know, they're gonna fill it with kids, and they're gonna be able to pay somebody to teach it. So please, go to things. Go to this dance this weekend. Spread the word to other parents. We want more of this. We would love to have a huge therapeutics and rec program like Plano does. But we have to have parents bring their kids. We've gotta have them.
Including them some more, so that
except for swim lessons, so we contract with quality instructors, and a lot of times their training is way better than what we have. Same as like we do, where we plan events with partners. We partner with contractors that have these special skills too. A lot of them are inclusive, and they're trained to work with all kinds of students. So don't shy away from the program just because it's not special to the group.
Yes, I actually had a dad ask me about an art class. And they made a deal where he was just going to send them for the one class, and if it didn't work out, it would be okay. And so I didn't hear anything for a few weeks, and also I got an email from the dad with all these attachments, and I started opening attachment after attachment, and I was crying. The beautiful artwork that his child, his middle schooler, had produced, it was outstanding. And he said it was just the best experience ever. The teacher went out of her way to accommodate and made it work, and it was absolutely fabulous for everyone. So just ask.
Alyssa is a good resource. If there's a class that maybe you want, call the instructor, maybe not, but how about this one? Like, she's very good at trying to figure out what.
And we've had requests to have the aides attend with children. We can do that as long as there's not a max capacity that's been. As long as the room itself will hold the extra people, they can have that. Sometimes it's just a matter of a background check because they're in a room with other children from other families. So, but yes, she's going to make a reasonable accommodation, whatever she can do. And those teachers are fantastic. I mean, obviously, sometimes it doesn't work out. We try new stuff all the time, but we'll definitely try. And they're quality classes, and they've been around. I think that art program has been around since we started having art programs. We'd love to have you contact us, email us, we'll leave you our information back there, Alyssa's, and we're really just special events, but we can get you in contact with everything.
Do you have a question?
I did. I think sometimes maybe the reluctance of participation is knowing the level that the teacher is comfortable, especially families that have children, but regular special needs. So what would your advice be on that? Contact specifically on this one instructor. What is their experience?
Yes. Because some of the instructors are college kids that have been hired to run a camp that's playing basketball. And then some of them are like our Synergy basketball program. He is a certified coach, teacher. He has amazing things going on, and he would be a very appropriate instructor, so she'll know that already, but she can also talk to them directly and get even tech with them directly. So that's the best way. Yeah. Just don't be scared to call her. She's not too busy. We're busy. We're not that busy. She wants you to come and have a good time.
All right.
Come
see us. Yay.
Okay, next up we have Frisco Public Library. Jen is here to tell you about all the amazing things that they are doing. They've been working for years on making Frisco Public Library more and more accommodating for our families and kids with special needs.
Hi everybody, my name is Jen Boschkoff and I'm the Senior Librarian at Frisco Public Library. First of all, I just want to say it's my first time here at this event and I am so amazed. I'm just so thrilled to see all the different services that are out there, and this has been really educating for me as well, so I'm really glad I was able to be here tonight. Because we are a place of information and resources, and so I hope maybe you can start pointing people in the right direction and maybe getting some help just beyond our walls as well. So I'm going to go through here and see what we got. Okay, so this is one of the things that we offer as a resource for people that have children with special needs. We have a sensory story time. It's basically once a month during each session, and it typically is on a Saturday. Yvette Mendez is our librarian who is the one that has created a lot of these programs and resources. I have her cards at my table back there, so if you want to have contact directly with the person that's responsible for a lot of this, you can do that. So this is a probably 20 to 25 minute program, and it occurs in our second floor in the news program room. There's not a whole lot of people that show up, which is a good thing, so that it's not overwhelming because the room is built for sound, so we get a little loud. But we do special books, we lower the lights a little bit, and we just make some other accommodations to make this a better and more enjoyable story time for children on the spectrum or who have sensory issues. And then we also have a Social Readers League. This is a newer addition to us, and it was interesting. I was really fascinated by your comments with Parks and Rec. We try different kind of programming all the time, and if people don't show up, it doesn't last. This one, we had nobody show up in September. So we're hoping to get the word out. Of course, we don't want to be bursting at the seams, obviously, but we would like participants. And this is for our tweens, which we're trying to increase that level of programming at the library because it's kind of an underserved population. We define that as grades 4 through 8. And this is an hour where they get to come and socialize with their peers. We have kids that are in the volunteer program at the library in our advisory group that volunteer their time to come in and socialize with their peers. They play games, they have snacks, if they want to read together, they read. That's why we call it the Social Readers League. And it's been a really great opportunity for a lot of kids who are coming on a regular basis. I think it was just the beginning of the school year, probably. But please come out because we'd like to see attendance on that study so that we can continue to offer that program. And then let me just go over a couple other things that we have. So, got my little cheat sheet, sorry. We have a sensory box that's brand new. We just put it out kind of at the end of the summer. It's available in our elementary room, which is kind of the back room on the second floor if you've ever been to the library. So it's a box that's kind of behind the Ask Us desk that's in that room. And it's got fidgets, it's got a couple of weighted, one like a lap blanket and then one for the shoulders. We've got a timer that's available. We've got earplugs if you've got a child that maybe needs to have earplugs in so they can concentrate on reading or whatever it is that they're doing. So lots of different things. It's there for you to use. You don't have to ask permission. Just go and grab what you need. And then we just ask that you put it away. Earplugs you can keep, but everything else, just put it back in the box for the next person to enjoy. That's our newest addition for the resources that we have available. And then we also have backpacks. We have sensory backpacks with lots of different themes. And then we also have diverse ability backpacks. So please come back by the table there. I'm happy to share all the different details of that. I have some handouts for you. You can actually take a look. I brought one of the sensory backpacks with me, so you can take a look at what's in there. Those are all available for checkout. You can have them for 2 weeks. You can have 2 backpacks per card. So if you've got multiple cards, then you can have multiple backpacks. That's all right. And then, of course, you would turn them in with your items downstairs on the first floor. So I'll be here for the rest of the evening. Please come back and see me, and I hope I can answer any other questions you have. Thank you.
Okay. next we have Texas Workforce Solutions. Christy, you've been so patient, thank you. And she's going to tell you all about what Texas Workforce Solutions does for our kids. Thank you.
Hi there, good evening. So, who here, are you guys familiar with vocational rehabilitation services? That term. So, we are a state agency. Our goal is to help individuals with diverse skills and abilities and seeking employment opportunities that's, you know, consistent with their personal strengths and so forth. The age group is 14 to 22, but I did have a middle school teacher ask about, of course, that age group, and we really do hope to reach that point. I would say 5 years ago, we really started to dig deep into transition, starting with seniors. So if you imagine trying to start transition services as a senior, there's a lot to do. And it just wasn't, we weren't able to serve the students to the best of our ability. So now, you know, partnering with Frisco and all the different districts throughout Texas, we are now starting younger. It's ninth grade. It's not middle school, but after she approached me, I texted my boss. I was like, hey, what can we do about middle school? I don't have a response yet, but we'll see. There's been a really big push with transition services strictly through, you know, due to the WIOA Act. So that's the Workforce Innovation Opportunity Act, and that's, you know, so that we can really serve students with different skills and abilities. And that's, I know you guys may, you know, how do you go about doing that? Well, a lot of that is through partnering with you guys and helping us partner with local community providers, local businesses, local just resources, mom and pop shops. You know, we're really trying to expand opportunities, but it's really difficult sometimes to get the buy-in from employers. And so we have, our services have expanded, and that we're now able to support different summer camps, different, you know, we partnered with UNT to do some independent living camps. That's a 2-week camp during the summer. There's a 1-week camp that is called College Wise. This year we had the first rollout with Texas Tech, and that was a 1-year pre-college camp. So we're continuously trying to grow. We're trying to do, I thought I saw this totally went blank on her name.
Jenny, yes.
So we're even trying to partner with them to see what kind of camps we can create for our students. So we're trying to get creative. And if you guys have any, you know, any suggestions or ideas, we would love to partner, you know, with anyone to try to make things happen for our students. So there is an eligibility criteria. You know, the student does have to have a disability that's an impairment in some way. They do need our support in order to reach a goal. So, you know, we'll go through the application process, and a lot of times, you know, we ask a question. The first question is, does the child's disability impact their ability to work? And a lot of times parents will say no. And so we kind of guide you guys through some of those questions, and that depending on the job, there might be that barrier. And so, because if we mark all these no-no-nos, then the level of support, you guys are telling us that we're not needed. So I think really all students could benefit from having kind of a mentor or career exploration. And you know, I think all of us could have benefited from that, you know, when we were in high school. So our ultimate goal as an agency is to help with that employment piece, but how that looks, it's very different for each unique student. So there's nothing I can say in regards to this is what it looks like, because we can be very creative in our field and exploring how we can best meet the needs of your child. So I know, you know, some of you guys may have younger children, and you may think, oh, this is not for my child right now, but transition actually starts now. You know, by maybe chores or just taking baby steps, so that when you guys reach middle school, we can then start to explore what those activities look like and how we can then build upon them. Let's see. I talk really fast. So let's see here, y'all. What else? Okay, pre-employment transition services. So that's the reason we have funding. So we receive state and federal funding, and the pre-employment transition services actually comes from that WIOA Act. So that's where we have the five core services, self-advocacy, work readiness, counseling on, post-secondary goals, work-based learning activities, self-advocacy, I think I said that, y'all. How many did I name out there? So career exploration. So our services are geared towards helping students explore these different areas. But of course, we can be very creative in going even beyond that, regarding independent living and so forth. So we are a state agency. I would say if you guys are uncertain about our services, just apply, and then we go from there. So, any questions? Yes, ma'am.
What's the best moment?
Mm-hmm. Do you, is there an upcoming ARD? That's a great way in regards to making kind of some of that first connection as well. Inviting someone from our agency to the ARD, or we can meet with you guys after the ARD to start that process. And we also have, and I can meet with you after this as well.
Jim, did you want to add to that?
Do you have any information about the memorandum of understanding between the TEA and you guys?
I would say go through Regenton for that. I don't have that. I could always locate that, but in regards to I don't have that.
So basically it's saying that the schools and the PWC are going to work together a lot closer than they have been in the past.
We have our policy and procedure in regards to, and I know there's the collaboration effort that's going on through Region 10 right now, and the statewide conference for that is actually next week. So we have our information that we can share with you guys in regards to how we can better support students through this transition process. And I'm sure through our regional or central office, we can gather maybe what you're looking for. And if you want to, we can always talk over there too. Okay. In this folder here, you'll see just general information about transition. We do have an adult program as well, so I just want to throw that out there. So you'll see info about the adult program, meaning 22 and older, and then transition 14 and 22. Thank you.
Make sure you're taking advantage of all of these resources and services. Okay, next up we have Frisco Sage. Ladies, come on down. Unless the whole board is here. Not to be confused with PTA Sage. I'm the one that gets the text to hurry up and get here because nobody else wants to talk, so. We have Frisco Sage. As she said, not to be confused with PTA Sage, but we work in collaboration with PTA Sage. Jean does her work through the PTA. We do our work wherever something's not covered. I would say that we're kind of the catch-all for someone says, we needed this or we wanted that, and we try to fill that gap. So I have a list of things we've done in the past year. I will not read all of them to you, but I'm going to make it bigger so my eyes will work. Thank you. Sorry, my eyes are finished. So we all have everyone on our board. We have several people on our board, and all of our all of our board members have children with special needs. We have different needs that we cover, or that our families cover, or that our children cover, I guess they do that. So we do, some of the things that we do is we do the moms at the high schools, like
Jean does it through PTA. Some of our PTAs do that at a few of the high schools, and then we try to cover all the rest of the high schools. I think we're getting all of them done, except we had one high school we couldn't get in touch with, and they had a very early homecoming, so we're doing all the rest of them, the ones that PTA aren't doing. We have helped our classes do some volunteering work in the community, like through, was it Fast Packs or Love Packs? Love Packs, sorry. We have bi-monthly coffee talks where families can come in and sit down and say, I'm having a problem with this, or have you ever experienced this? We were all at one point, I think we were all at some point, or most of us were here at early childhood school. My son was here when it opened. That's kind of where I met most of these ladies, actually. And so our kids are now middle school, so we've kind of been through that. We had people before us that we would ask questions to, like, I know Debbie. I asked Debbie, what do you do about this when this happens? Or what, you know, is the kids are growing up and hitting different things. So we talk about things like that at the coffee talks, ways that you can be a positive advocate for your child, how to ask for what you want, and things like that. We do family nights, and that's where we get together with our families, and we bring everyone. And the only rule we have at family nights is you're not allowed to apologize. Mm-hmm. I learned that the first year when I showed up and I started apologizing for everything my son did, and somebody said, you're not allowed to apologize here. And that's actually a relief to me that we can just go and be who we are. We are part of the Chamber of Commerce. We have inclusion t-shirt sales. Oh goodness. There's a long list here. We have a lot of business partnerships. We partner with businesses throughout the community, and we also work with them. Most recently, we've taken the Diverse Abilities Day program that Jean told you about, and we sent it to a company that works with Fortune 500 companies, and they are looking at using it as part of their training for making not only business people aware of people with special needs and how to serve special needs, but also how to bring them into your company, how you can have a friendly office space so that when our kids get older, they have places that they can work and people that understand them and their needs. And of course, my picture went away. Let's see. We've assisted with Special Olympics, helping them secure partnerships and volunteer and donations. We've done North Texas Giving Day, which is today. We've done Give Frisco, which is part of the Mayor's Council. We're one of his recognized nonprofits. We have a blog, a Facebook page, a Facebook group that's private. We do Amazon Smile. We've done Special Olympics basketball track. We're kind of the great connectors. We kind of connect all of these things together, but we kind of tend to be the people that people come to when they first move here. And they're like, I don't know anything about Frisco. I don't know what's here for my child. What's out there for us? We just kind of help. We help with the Lending Library and the Parent Sanctuary. We had our first sensory friendly prom this year, where we had our high school students and our 18 plus students come in. That was the most fun prom ever. I'm not even kidding you. I retook my prom picture with my best friend from high school, who also has a special needs child. Way more fun than my high school prom. Much more lively, and just as much breakdancing as 1980 something. We were not doing that. Yes, all our pictures. Our pictures are on the Facebook page. We've got a ridiculous number of pictures from last year. We have visited and toured a lot of the therapy centers. Talked to them about connecting with our families. We toured Nonparole Institute last year, which is a program for students after they exit high school program if they're high functioning and are interested in technology. We created over the summer a program called Grants in memory of a student, one of our first FISD students. And so we just do things throughout the community. We try to make the community aware. So we're involved in the school district. Oh, we do the Partners PE trainings, forgot to say that, which is amazing. And if you've never gotten to, sorry, Natalie, so right going to anyone, what about us? We do the special loans to them also. But if you've never been to a Partners PE training or a Best Buddies program, our typical students in this district, they love their kids. They really, really, really do. So if you ever feel like my kid goes to school and he's invisible, I promise you, your kid is not invisible in our schools. The district people love them.
I'm always shocked when I go into the administration building and I walk in and people are like, oh, Raymond's mom, right? I'm like, okay, I know I have an unusual last name, but how do you know my child? Oh, well, back in the day, I whatever, whatever. I'm like, good grief. So people love your kids while they're at school. They really do. Your teachers love them. Your administrators love them. The other students love them. They take care of them. They watch out for them. So just know that, you know, that's kind of our part, is to let you know that your kids are loved and we're here to help in any way we can. And I just have to add that Melanie, as part of the board, she automated the whole Parent Sanctuary Lending Library. It's very exciting this year. We now have an automated check-in system, checkbook checkout system, check back-in system. So now we can keep data on exactly how many parents are coming through, what schools are sending the most parents. So we're really, really excited about that. And they are volunteers in the Lending Library, as is Jean. The collaboration in this district, it's just, I can't even say enough. It's the best place ever to work and be a parent, and just, if you're not involved, get involved, because it's so exciting. You're missing out if you're not involved. Okay, and last but not least, we have Best Buddies, Casey.
Hi guys, my name is Casey Tugman. I'm the program manager of Mission Expansion for Best Buddies here in the DFW area and beyond. I say beyond because actually my service area is essentially the parts of Texas that fall north of Waco. So we have chapters in Tyler, we have a chapter at Abilene Christian University. We actually just opened a chapter in Clarksville, so, which is near Paris. Very, very expansive service area, and we have a great deal of support here in Frisco. And essentially what Best Buddies is, if you haven't heard about it, is we're an organization that seeks to normalize friendship and create a world where all of us are seen for our abilities and who we are, not who we're not. So I say normalize friendship because that's one of the pieces of our puzzle. We have a four-pillar mission, the one-to-one friendships, integrated employment, so we're actually a Texas Workforce Solutions employment services provider. We also do leadership trainings and create ambassadors to help us promote our Best Buddies mission. We have a training coming up on October 5th. So if any of your students have been part of a Best Buddies chapter here in Frisco, or even if they just love what Best Buddies is about and they want to come learn about how to tell their story and how to advocate, we'll have that at Ability Connection from 9 to noon on Saturday, October 5th, and that's for really middle school and up. Our programs are, our one-to-one friendship programs are in the middle schools, high schools, colleges, and we're working to develop corporate citizens chapters. And I didn't say elementary school, but we do have programs in elementary school. We just don't institute the one-to-one friendship piece. They fall under what we call promoter chapters. Promoter chapters are programs that, for whatever reason, don't have the one-to-one friendship piece. Typically, those are where, like in the elementary school setting, we're starting that inclusion conversation. We're having activities and events, and we're starting to, at a young age, make sure that kids, the stereotypes are being broken down so that as they go into middle school and high school, that inclusion is happening. Other promoter chapters would be, for whatever reason, if the school does not have special ed on campus, or we only have one of them in Houston, but if you have a school of entirely special needs kids that doesn't have general education on campus, that they want to promote the mission, and so we love that as well. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to stay afterwards to talk with you guys one-on-one because I live an hour away and it's a little bit late for me. So I'm going to leave some information, my business cards, information on how to start a chapter if you would like to bring this into your elementary school campus, and just some general information about the Best Buddies programs. So thank you guys so much for the opportunity to be here today, and I really appreciate you guys.
Workforce Solutions wanted to say something really quick to in response to a question. So that was really bothering me. And so, okay, so you Google, you can search for that MOU. It has all eight pages of students and everything between K
PEA and Texas workforce. So I just wanted to let you guys know that all of y'all have access to that.
And also one more piece, Jenny Jensen, she owns the Brick Lab here in Frisco, and she has a social skills class on Fridays. If you're interested in that information, you can see her. She's right there. Okay, and that is all. Now you will have an opportunity to go to the specific tables to ask the questions that you have. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Remember to take a